My name's Mark Cousins. I'm a filmmaker.
Look, it's Belfast, my hometown. It's weird being up so high, you know, when you know a place from the grassroots, to be up this high, and there's a kind of grandeur, you know, there's a lot of sad stuff happened here, but being up is kind of beautiful, I think.
In 1969, when I was 4 years old, the Troubles erupted after a summer of violence. British soldiers arrived to restore order, escalating a conflict that would last 30 years. As the Troubles happened, I fell in love with movies. Lots of people in Ireland did. We flocked to the big screen. Before the Troubles, people in Belfast went to the pictures more than most in the UK.
It feels very cinematic being up here. And I think when you go back to a place that you haven't been to in a long time, that feels cinematic too. You feel as if you're in a flashback in your own life.
Belfast filmmaker Brian Henry Martin has asked me to look back at the Troubles and at movies, what happened to movie going in those years, and to our imaginations. Belfast today, a peace wall still separates the Catholic Falls Road and the Protestant Shankill Road. It looks like a backbone. I had families on both sides of the backbone. This road from one side to the other is still closed at night. Because we're filming, I get to open it. It's moving for me. Movies open doors. Do they open minds too? Did they open mine?
I feel so happy in a cinema. And for me, it's like a harbor. It's a shelter from the storm. You can't see the world out there. It's safe, it's quiet. And it's really, really this place where you unravel. Even from childhood, I was quite a nervy little boy. The Troubles had a kind of low intensity vibration which made you always feel slightly unsafe. I was also bullied at school quite a lot, and I was quite bright at school, and so they picked on you, and I was skinny and very unsporty. All these things made you feel that the outside world was slightly dangerous. When we were young, lots of us craved the cinema. It was kind of a lifeline. It was like something to hold on to. Felt as if movies took you by the hand and said, let me show you places. Let me take you somewhere more beautiful, more real, less skewed by politics and fear.
Movies have always done that. When people flocked to the movies in the 1940s and 50s, before the Troubles, they went to see elsewhere. They were mostly working class, and Ireland's Western gaze meant that Doris Day and John Wayne went deep into our imaginations. Hollywood back projection, optimism, and a fantasy Wild West.
Whip crack away.
We saw such fantasies in places like this. The Ritz was Belfast's great movie palace. A pleasure dome, once the biggest cinema in Ireland, with more than 2,000 seats. The Beatles played here. But the Ritz was firebombed in 1977. One less place to escape to. The Ritz is gone, as are many old cinemas in other cities. But across the street is another kind of palace. One with its own role to play in our film story.
The Crown Bar, most famous place in Belfast. I remember coming here as a boy a lot. My dad drank here, and what we loved about it was it wasn't like Belfast. It's Gothic, it's European. Not only was it European, it was exotic. Look for a minute, and what also does it remind you of? The movie palaces. Those movie palaces of the 1930s, 40s, and 50s were purposefully exotic. They had Egyptian decor, they had African decor, they had Asian decor. There are paintings of pineapples here. What's Belfast about pineapples? What's Northern Ireland about pineapples? You know, you felt rich here. You felt like a prince in this place.
Did I bring you to the police court in my cab? Come on, get out.
The film Odd Man Out was set in the Crown Bar. Expressionist bubbles. James Mason's agony. He's trying to escape his feelings, maybe like we were trying to escape ours.
I saw Odd Man Out on TV when I guess I was 11, I don't know exactly when. And it was kind of shocking. Because this was clearly supposed to be an IRA man, but he was incredibly handsome and glamorous, and he was like a Christ-like figure, this man played by James Mason. He's walking along slowly, and at certain points it snows. It's that, you know, that phrase, the Via Dolorosa, the sad walk that Christ makes, and here it was, you know. So this was a mythic Belfast, it was an imaginary Belfast, it was a film noir Belfast. I think great art feels close to life, but is distant in some way. If you think of the great Russian icon paintings, the Christ figure doesn't look right at you. He looks just over your shoulder to another world, a kind of paradise, and you're supposed to think paradise is really quite close. When we watch Odd Man Out, it's something similar. It's not looking right at us, but it's sort of looking just adjacent. You know, a sort of stylized version of this city, Belfast, this war, you know, this kind of sadness. We used to play in this park when we were really, really young. You know, I remember my granddad pushing us in our prams around, reeling around this fountain, you know, and it was great, you know, the world seemed very big, but we're talking about, you know, 1969 or something like that. But then, of course, the troubles came. You know, kids pick up fear from the adults around them, from their parents. And I remember there was a sort of abstract sense of insecurity, of danger or something, and we were picking it up from the adults. The adults were trying to hide that from us, I'm sure. And I mean our whole generation, not just my family. But nonetheless, you get it. It was like a high-pitched noise. I remember a strong image of my mom said, we had a glass door in the bottom of the hall on the way out, and she said, if you go into the hall and you see a shadow, if you see a man behind that door, run back in. So suddenly there was a sense of fear on the periphery of our world, and it felt as if the world like closed in. And I think it probably happened for lots of children in the early 70s. You didn't play out so much, you know, if you had a yard, you played in the backyard. Of course, we didn't know what was happening, but there was a sense of the world getting smaller.
Hello.
Are stories about two things, the Troubles in Northern Ireland and movies? How did films affect us? How did they affect me? How did violence affect us? The city centre slowly closed down. It wasn't safe to go out at night, and even during the day, you had to keep your wits about you. The images we saw hurt us. They had to. During the early 70s, the violence in Northern Ireland had become commonplace. The worst year was 1972, when almost 500 people were killed. On Bloody Friday, 22 bombs ripped the city apart. Not only did the violence hurt us, it stole from us too. It stole many of our cinemas. This is the Broadway cinema on the Falls Road, firebombed, destroyed in 1972. It never reopened. I left Ireland and began making films and, surprise, surprise, was attracted to troubled places. This is a folder of my trip to Iran. I went there in 2005, interviewed lots of people, etc., and then we went to the old movie theatres. Many of them had been burnt or destroyed at the time of the revolution in 1979, some of them untouched since then. And I went to one and I found this in the rubble. Old movie footage. I don't know what it is, but it's 35mm film. It looks like silent footage almost, you know, and very beautiful, poignant to find it in the rubble. I remember cleaning it, it was covered in dust. I've kept it ever since. It just seemed to say quite a lot about what happened in a society like Iran, that this great entertainment, this sparkling entertainment, was being left in the rubble, just untouched. And so to find this, it was finding like a little kind of jewel in the dirt. And you realize this cinema was destroyed for a reason, because the revolutionaries, some of whom had good intent, they did not trust people's pleasure. They wanted to destroy pleasure and the cinematic imagination. It's very, very easy to destroy art, but to destroy art is a sign that something is really rotten in the national imagination or in the personal imagination. Closer to home in Northern Ireland, there's a kind of unique sadness in a burnt out cinema. Cinemas are luminous. It's like we live in winter, and when we look up at the big screen, it's summer. There's something so alive about a movie theater. And so when a movie theater dies, it's a particularly sad death. Bread and Roses. I think that's what this documentary's about. Survival and beauty. In the Troubles, we needed both. Most people do. The abnormal became normal, like being searched for incendiary devices when we stepped into the cinema. Absurdity off-screen was matched with absurdity on it.
They were young and in love.
Oh, you're shameless.
Like this ridiculous love story set against the backdrop of our troubles.
The rest of the world's problems seemed almost insignificant.
Dodge.
We decided last night, Bridget and me.
We're going to be married.
But to the people in their town.
Bridget Slattery's still going with that soldier.
Sure, she'll never learn.
It's time she learned.
What they were doing was blasphemy.
Some cinemas escaped the Troubles, went dormant before the war broke out, lay in wait, hidden in plain sight. This cinema was called the Apollo, the Greek god of light. The first talkie cinema in Belfast, it closed in 1962. This is a pretty complicated setup here, sitting in this place. We have a double dereliction here. This was a cinema and it closed down. It was a Chinese supermarket and it closed down, but it went to a bigger place. So cinema was going downhill and Chinese culture here in Northern Ireland was going uphill. This cinema never knew the Troubles. Since the last film screened here, the conflict has come and gone. For the first time in nearly 60 years, I've been asked to show a film here. This film's called Spring in a Small Town, and lots of people think it's the best Chinese film ever made. It's about a Chinese woman in love with two men immediately after the Chinese Revolution. The most iconic scene in this film is the woman walking on the walls of the old town, the town that's no more, that has fallen apart. And there's a lovely sense of her solitude. There's no one else in the frame. She walks. She's not saying anything, but we hear her inner thoughts. She talks about wanting to float out of this world. That sense that the movie can tell us something about society, that there's been a war or a revolution, but also can take us right into her emotions, right into her fears, right into her poetic view of the world. That's wonderful. More specifically, what's moving about this film for a Belfast and Northern Irish audiences, this is about love in war. We see in this film scenes of crumbling walls, falling down buildings, and yet it's about the recovery, that even in the aftermath of war, even in bombed out places, we still fall in love and we still feel the agonies of the human heart. And this film captures that beautifully. During the Troubles, we painted our crumbling walls. We decorated our division on the bombed out buildings in our communities. And a generation like mine growing up in this, we shared a troubled childhood and a need for escape. We've been talking about movie going in the 70s. What do you remember about going to movies in the 70s?
It's all we had to do, really. I mean, I always tell people the reason why I get into doing music for films is because most of the time in the 70s I wasn't allowed out. So I spent my whole time watching movies. The Curzon was our local cinema and it was literally a stone's throw away. And we used to just go there all the time.
Did you think the Troubles damaged you? Did it make you feel scared, anxious?
Everyone that lives here has been affected by the Troubles in some way, in ways that they just actually don't even understand. But there is a great luxury of living in a place where there was absolutely nothing to do, because all you had was your imagination. Watching movies late at night, just pretending to be asleep in my room, but I was actually having these really profound, life-changing experiences through watching sort of cinema and, which is just pure escapism when you're living in a city that's got a civil war going outside.
It's striking how positively you talk. I don't think I'd heard you say that thing about, you know, all we had is our imaginations. And especially if there are other, more material things are quite limited, then I guess your imaginative life is a bigger part of your life or something. But I hadn't really, it's a very positive way to talk about those years, I think. More positive than I am.
Well, actually, one of my fondest memories, when the video recorder arrived in the early 80s, you were either Betamax or VHS.
Yeah.
We were VHS. Mm. But, you know, at the corner of our street, there were a family that had a pirate video library. Mm-hmm. And you'd go and you'd wrap the door and you'd come in and there'd be all the Betamax would be on one side and all the VHS would be on the other. But in the middle, the family were sitting eating their dinner. And you were just going through, and what's this like? Oh, yeah, that's a brilliant film. You know, passes the brown sauce. You know, and, you know, leave the money there and I'll drop it back tomorrow. But that, stuff like that was amazing, especially because of the troubles. And being young and not being allowed out, like it was, you can't go out tonight because there was shit happening on the streets.
Yeah.
So what did you do, you know? Watch movies.
Passes the brown sauce. What David says helps me understand why movies matter in war. The Troubles closed cinemas. It sort of killed cinemas in the way, but it did not kill cinephilia, the love of movies. It sent it underground behind closed doors. These things came along, you know, they're like a box of chocolates almost, VHS tapes. Watching films at home in this way was certainly illicit. We knew that the priests wouldn't approve of it. We knew that the nuns wouldn't approve of it. We knew that the Presbyterians wouldn't approve of it. There was nobody at the cinema door saying, you can't watch this, you're too young. And so we watched stuff that was probably age inappropriate, shall we say. And that was great. For example, I was desperate to see The Exorcist, one of the scariest films. We were very religious when I saw it still. Remember that scene where the priest arrives and it's all dark and misty, and our priests, I remember watching that and thinking our priests would hate this. But the very way we watched The Exorcist was special. We were in my aunt's house, we got the video, took it out of the box, put it in, and someone, I think maybe my aunt, splashed holy water on the video player. You know, it felt scary enough, the build-up was big enough, but to bless the piece of equipment felt kind of wonderful and dangerous and dark, like the film was dark. Forcing something underground doesn't kill it. And I think that what happened to our love of cinema is it became something that we couldn't do in public. We had to do it in private, almost in secret. We had to hide it, which made it seem more potent. And it was almost like a drug that you would share when nobody was looking. Secrecy was shaping us. Paranoia was setting in. That too was streaming in through the small screen.
Help restore peace to Ulster. Any information you've got about explosions, murders, other serious crimes, ring the confidential telephone number in your area. You'll see the numbers advertised. When you ring, a recording machine will say,
"This is the police confidential telephone. Please speak now."
I left Northern Ireland in 1983. I wanted to turn my back on it, literally. Now when I look at it, I think rather differently, but I was a teenager, I was arrogant, I was adventurous. I wanted to leave. In Scotland, I had the time and space to think. One of the things I thought about was the role that escapism and culture play in a city. Behind us is the city of the Enlightenment, Edinburgh. And then I started working here in Edinburgh, and I realized, you know, the biggest arts festival in the world happens right here. And why did they start that arts festival in 1947? To heal the wounds of war. What a brilliant thing, and how relevant to us in Northern Ireland, you know, that culture can heal the wounds of war. In Scotland in the 1980s and 90s, I saw Hollywood films about our intractable little war. It was fun to see how they showed my home patch. The Troubles had gone widescreen, Mickey Rourke all style and attitude, lovely compositions. We were on the silver screen now. We had become escapism. Well-intentioned shite. It was flattering in a way that Hollywood tried to enter our world. But it was a kind of ventriloquism. But then again, so were the Doris Day movies from long ago. One film in particular, which took us beyond ventriloquism, was Neil Jordan's Angel. I saw it in Belfast's Queen's Film Theatre. Jordan was from the Republic of Ireland, but his film had Belfast's Stephen Ray in the lead role. Seeing him on the big screen, so honestly, so cinematically, was astounding. An ascent, a coup d'état de cinéma. The year before Angel, real events in Northern Ireland captured the world's attention. The 1981 hunger strike was the culmination of a 5-year protest by Irish Republican prisoners. Again, movies set about interpreting the conflict, sometimes by people who lived the Troubles, who were at the centre of them. Lawrence McKeown, now a playwright, took part in the hunger strike in which Bobby Sands and 9 other Republican prisoners died.
They said after 3 days, you're not hungry anymore. Your stomach starts to shrink so that you don't feel so empty.
You were a participant in the hunger strikes, and then you made a film about your old film, about your experience. Why did you make that film?
Well, I think that the betrayal of Republicans was very much this idea of people who were psychopaths, terrorists, criminals, whatever you want to say, generally, you know, people who were beyond the law. And in terms of what their politic was or why they were motivated to do this, it wasn't really elaborated on. So in terms of writing H3, what we wanted to show was that, you know, the people who have been involved in conflict, and regardless whether it's Republican side or Unionist side or British Army side or just basically ordinary people.
Who's top of the first division?
Villa. Villa, they beat Birmingham 3-0 last Saturday. Ipswich are second.
And I
sell like
doing.
They're top.
Go on,
there was a scene in it where a young guy comes in and he's been asked about, you know, but the football teams are Man United and Liverpool and Celtic, and but who's in the charts these days? And it's not about IRA things or political things. I know there's sing songs and there's laughter, and it's basically we're trying to show the humanity of people in it. As well as the circumstances that were there and the hard decisions that were having to be made. And but yeah, so it was to, I suppose, challenge maybe what we've seen as the other images that were being put out at that time, which again have now changed in the later years. Like Hunger was made, and you know, it was praised and won the Palme d'Or, etc. So, but that was my motivation really to do it. It was to tell what was a very important part of history here, but my also personal history.
And what to say about director Steve McQueen's Hunger? After seeing it, Hollywood's Hard Men films seemed weaker still. They'd neither looked, nor listened, nor thought. Hunger did something else. It looked and listened. It showed us bodies as battered as those in Dutch Pieta paintings, and bleeding knuckles and falling snow. The small war I knew and the medium of film that I loved were getting closer together. They were combining.
I think one of the most cinematic things ever made about The Troubles wasn't a piece of cinema at all. It was a 39-minute TV show from 1989, directed by Alan Clark. The Troubles, we were used to the cliches, you know, the love across the barricades, the thriller, the psychopathic terrorist, the romantic freedom fighter. This film had none of these. It was just a picture of 18 assassinations. People walking through space, killing other people. We didn't hear who the killers were or who the killed was. There was almost no dialogue, almost no music. Utterly spare, boldly cinematic because of the sense of space, the sense of being there. It used a Steadicam in a remarkable way, constantly going through these industrial spaces or these grasslands that were supposed to be Belfast. The Steadicam in this film made us think of Stanley Kubrick's The Shining, those haunted corridors, or John Carpenter's Halloween, those haunted suburbs. Maybe Belfast was a haunted corridor or a haunted suburb also. But I think in a deeper sense, it said something really troubling, because it featured the gun all the time, but because the camera was moving all the time, it almost was like the gun was a camera. Shooters talk about shooting. We, when we use our camera like this, we talk about shooting. And it raised the really profound question for all cinema. Maybe cinema is too good at violence. Maybe it likes guns too much. Call the film Elephant was just, it was made by English people, this film, and it was like a j'accuse to us. It was saying to us, okay, you know, let's forget all the reasons why you kill each other. Just let's look at the pure mechanism of murder and look at the atrocity of that. This big, solemn thing, the elephant, this huge thing in your lives is, you know, blocking your vision of the world. And when you watched Elephant, despite all the speed at which the assassins moved, there was something extremely numbing about the whole process, the whole depiction of violence. No psychology, nothing, just bang, bang, bang. By the early 1990s, there was still a relentless drip drip of killing, and there were devastating bomb attacks in Belfast city centre. But although we didn't know it at the time, peace talks were underway.
This is an amazing place. I don't know if I've ever been anywhere like this. You might say, when people asked us what the Troubles felt like, maybe it was something like this. You can't see the outside world here. You can't hear the outside world here. And during those awful years, there was a similar feeling. You know, it was like we were underground. Echo chambers are bad for you. Hearing your own voice, hearing only like-minded people, not having any contact with the outside world. No wonder solitary confinement is used as a kind of torture in some ways. You know, whether an individual or a society is an echo chamber, it's only hearing its own ideology makes it imperiled. It's bad for its mental health, bad for its social health. Unbelievably, we're under Belfast's river here. The River Lagan. I've never, of course, been under a river knowingly in my life before. I used to talk about the Troubles as being like a tide, that you were slightly drowning, you know, but this is something different. This is a kind of topsy-turvy thing. You shouldn't be under water and be dry. You should be wet. It should be euphoric. Director Brian has me filmed in slow-mo, totally naked, in a freezing loch in Scotland. He has a metaphor in mind, I think. He wants to see me emerge from the water, the wave. He wants to show that the Troubles didn't drown me. He's right, they didn't. And most people were far better swimmers than me, more buoyant, more resilient. When the ceasefires happened, when the Good Friday Agreement happened, like lots of people, I cried.
Yes, 71.12%.
Yeah! The conflict was over. It was now time for peace. And guess what? Cinema going in Belfast recovered somewhat after the Good Friday Agreement. When conflicts end, the spring that has long been compressed jumps upwards. Old loves die hard.
No leaders.
Films about us and our recent war have continued to be made. Good Vibrations, set in Belfast's famous record shop that remained open throughout the Troubles, took us back to being teenagers. It showed the bits of our imaginations that refused to be colonized.
When it comes to punk, New York has the haircuts, London has the trousers, but Belfast has the reason!
So if some films coax us backwards to see what, at the time, we were too compressed to see, others seem like a blow upon a bruise. '71, about a British soldier trying to survive in West Belfast during the fighting, sounded so naive. But the film avoided the potholes. It had a nighttime atmosphere and scenes of childhood. We were in angel land again.
Please don't bring them back here. Stay quiet. Shh.
The soldiers may be long gone, but enemy lines are harder to erase. The backbone again. We call them peace walls, but many people in Belfast still live segregated lives, almost as much as they did at the height of the Troubles.
Look how high it is. On this side, it's the Protestant side. These are mostly working class Protestants. Across there It's supposed to be a very different species of human being, the Catholics. And of course, we know they're no difference. This is called an artwork, a mural, our Berlin Wall. But let's face it, this is an obscenity. The fact that in our city, these lovely people and these lovely people have to be divided by this thing is an utter fucking disgrace. And are there one or two of these? No, there are 100 of them, and we cannot have that. This needs to go down. We need to kick this down. And look at this, smash the wall of separation. How could you possibly say it better? I'm being filmed getting a tattoo. My tats are the names of filmmakers I admire, whose movies inspire me. Ukrainian Kira Muratova, Alfred Hitchcock, Farrugh Farrokhzad, the great Iranian feminist poet and filmmaker, Kinyo Tanaka, a superb Japanese actress who became a director. As I say this, I realize that I have the world on my arms, the movie world. Cinema has taken me around the world. My new tat is of Jibril Diop Mombeti, Senegalese punky, maybe Africa's greatest filmmaker. This particular filmmaker, you know, will now be on my arm forever, and I'm pleased to be there. It's, you know, when you've something in your head, and you sort of, if it's in there, it might as well be outside. I feel the pain of the needle, but then the endorphins kick in and my body relaxes a bit. Like it relaxes when the lights go down in a cinema. And I realize that the story we've been trying to tell in this film is sort of on my arms. When I was growing up, you know, Belfast was what it was. It was this rock pool. It was this microcosm. Our whole world was here. But then I started to travel and live a bit, and I became really aware of the rest of the world. I started to feel as if I was part of a common human family. And the most striking thing in my arms is how international the tattoos are. We're always changing, you know, and I think ride that change, don't fight it. Ride it is the thing that for me has always been interesting. Change in Northern Ireland will allow us to forget old backgrounds, the old backdrops we thought we were stuck with. Peace gave us the opportunity to reinvent ourselves, and in some ways we have. We now make films and TV shows that are seen all around the world. If culture heals the wounds of war, then we can afford, we owe it to ourselves, to dream bigger. Look at this place. This is supposed to be the center of our capital city. 100 years ago, this was our Champs-Élysées. This was, you know, there were entertainment buildings here. There was dazzling lights here. This is where you came to show yourself, what in Italy called the passeggiata, you know, where you go and show off and you have fun. It was a string of pearls, and look at it now. You know, there's hardly anyone here. There's a little solitary bus going by. But if we do not rejuvenate this boulevard, then what have we got? The troubles killed the heart of the city. It stabbed the heart of the city. You know, look at that gorgeous Art Deco building there. That's been derelict for years, decades. People in this city have loved cinema since the birth of cinema, and we can do it. We can relight, re-illuminate this town. Our imagination is recovering. The troubles damaged us, but the scar is healing.
the legacy, a fascination with escapism, with exile, in particular the luminous exile of the movies.
And Mark Cousins introduces a series of films over the next three nights as Jack O'Connell stars in 71. The Troubles on Film Season on Film 4 next, and tomorrow at 20 past 11, Stephen Ray, Jay Davidson and Forrest Whitaker bring us a tale of love, loyalty, murder and seduction in the Oscar-winning movie The Crying Game. Next night, though, here on Channel 4, an all-star cast in The Monuments Men.